36 years later, Top Gun is back, and bigger than ever. That's how you're supposed to start, right? And look, Top Gun is back, and it is bigger than ever, but it's a very odd kind of sequel. Or it isn't odd. It isn't odd, and that's why it's odd. It's odd that it's not odd. Okay, look, let's go back and talk about Top Gun. So here's the first big thing. Top Gun is not a war movie. Oh yeah, they're in fighter jets, and they're military officers. Top Gun goes as far as manufacturing some kind of shadow war. It really wants you to believe that American and Soviet fighter jets were secretly shooting each other down in conflicts all over the world in the 1980s. Something which, to be clear, really isn't true, so that the fighter jets can be shooting at other fighter jets. But the movie does not care about the enemy, about the necessity of war, either in specific or in general, about how war transforms us, or about the psychological effects of killing. Lots of war movies try to keep the stakes low to the ground, be more about the soldiers than the broader conflict, but Top Gun obfuscates the conflict to such a degree that it is rarely entirely clear who is fighting, what they're fighting over, or whether they're fighting. What Top Gun is a young man's coming-of-age story in which the military and the Top Gun program stand in for the, you know, the boarding school, the new location the young man goes to that sets off the events of growing up. Just with an opportunity to take a typically pretty down-tempo genre and introduce a high-adrenaline setting that just takes the whole thing to maximum energy. Okay, let me put this another way. Top Gun is the same story as The Fast and the Furious Tokyo Drift. Really, let's go through it. Our hero is 1. A young cocky womanizer who's 2. Really good at what he does, but 3. He just can't follow the rules. 4. So he gets dumped off to hard-ass academy. 5. He shows remarkable adaptability, but 6. He's also stymied by the new challenge. He's good, but his new hard-ass peers are just as good, and he's got a lot to learn. 7. Along the way, he makes new friends. 8. Starts up a rivalry with someone equally talented who fits into this different social group better. And 9. Falls for the wrong girl. 10. His relationship with the girl deepens surprisingly, and he realizes he wants more from her than he's ever wanted from a relationship before. 11. Meanwhile, his recklessness causes the conflict between the hero and rival to escalate. 12. Leading to the death of his best friend and fan favorite character. In the aftermath, 13. He reconciles with his father and learns to deal with his problems like a man. Then, 14. He defeats his rival once and for all, demonstrating his total domination of his society, and with that accomplished, 15. Settles down with his girlfriend. Okay, so the similarities are uncanny, but my point is not that there's some kind of copying going on. It's that there's a genre formula, and both of these movies are taking that approach and escalating it for many of the same reasons. Now, here's the thing. Once you get that Tokyo Drift isn't a racing movie, it's a coming-of-age movie using racing, the whole movie slots right into place. The same is not true of Top Gun. Take their approach to masculinity. Male coming-of-age stories are definitionally all about figuring out how to be a man. So, you know, masculinity is a big deal here. Quick disclaimer, I'm about to talk about different movies' depictions of masculinity for a while, so I'm going to discuss the values claims those movies make. Some of those values claims are kind of fucked up. Moving on. So, what does it mean to be a man in a coming-of-age movie? A man figures out what he wants and he goes and gets it.
I mean, you're sitting on a winning lottery ticket. You're too much of a pussy to cash it in. And that's bullshit.
A man sticks to who he is instead of changing himself to fit in.
If you want to be a true friend to him, be honest and unmerciful.
A man stands up against unfairness. A man learns self-discipline and doesn't quit.
No need fight anymore. You prove a point.
But what point? That I can take a beating? I mean, every time I see those guys, they're gonna know they got the best of me.
A man does the right thing and faces the consequences himself.
Well, gentlemen, when the shit hits the fan, some guys run and some guys stay.
So, in Tokyo Drift, when Sean learns how to be a man, what does that mean? He takes on his problems instead of running from them. He backs up his big talk. He treats his elders with respect, while keeping his own dignity. He leads rather than following or going it alone. He respects his woman. Very normal stuff. So, how does Top Gun talk about masculinity? Oh boy. Okay, let's start with the idea that the movie is about or features a prominent subtext of repressed homosexuality.
It is a story about a man's struggle with his own homosexuality. That's it. That is what Top Gun is about, man.
And it doesn't, even if I get why people say it does. It's one of those things that sounds half convincing if you only vaguely remember Top Gun, because it's just not really there in the text. First of all, the guy Maverick's supposed to be into, Val Kilmer's character Iceman, is not all that present in the movie, and you can note this as one of the weird things about Top Gun, that the conflict is supposed to be this rivalry with Iceman, but Iceman only shares a couple of scenes with Maverick, and the big one is the shower scene, which we'll come back to, but while Iceman represents a foil and a conflicting perspective that Maverick plays off, they're just not actually interacting enough to have a sense of any kind of relationship between them. Second, Maverick's relationship with Charlie is key to the story. Charlie's character is interesting. Especially important, Charlie is older than Maverick. She's seen guys like him before, and she can match wits with him, and even toy with him. And that's the reason he falls for her, that he has to grow up for her. So what does masculinity mean in Top Gun? Well, a man fits in. I know it's weird, but it is what it is. A boy is reckless, untamed, cocky, aggressive. A man puts his talents to use for his community. A boy gets caught in his rival's jet wash. A man puts himself on the line for his peers. A boy needs to win the Top Gun trophy. A man congratulates his rival for winning. A boy womanizes. A man settles down. It's a little weird. Not that it doesn't fit at all, but remember all those other coming-of-age stories I talked about? Those are all about individualistic values, about defending your pride and dignity against the world. Top Gun is kind of the opposite. Some of the weirder stuff in the movie makes a little more sense in this context. Like Iceman, who's Maverick's foil in being a highly skilled but safe pilot who just doesn't make mistakes, is right about everything, and Maverick just learns to be like him. Or the movie's fascination with how much everything costs. Part of that is the fantasy, the getting to play with these ludicrously expensive toys, but how the monetary value of the plane is framed by the movie as even more important than the pilots' lives? Well, that feeds into the lesson about fitting in. Maverick's community has made an investment in him, and he has to learn to respect that. I spent a bunch of time looking at this little sequence here where Maverick goes from playing beach volleyball in jeans to a date without taking a shower in between, but it actually makes total sense, because Maverick is wild, is rough and tumble, and sure, there's something attractive, even magnetic about that, but at the same time, he needs to be civilized. But I'm not going to ignore the, you know, or the, you know. And, you know, the movie is really incredibly sweaty, not metaphorically, really sweaty. If you've been watching along, you've absolutely noticed. They're all sweating, all the time, just all the time. Why? Okay, 4 points, so let's try to keep them short. Point one, all these sweaty, half-dressed male bodies are there to make the pilots seem physically powerful. Everyone thinks jet planes are cool, and pilots are cool because they get to pilot jet planes, but the actual scenes of combat consist of the pilots just kinda sitting, while the planes they're in do cool things. There's not really a lot of opportunity in the story to demonstrate the characters' physicality and make them seem cool. I don't think most people really believe this straight up, but there's always been a persistent sentiment that the Air Force, or in this case naval aviation, is a safer and less physically demanding and therefore less real branch of the armed forces, and these scenes help to counteract that. Point two. The four-quadrant movie. If you're not familiar with the term, a four-quadrant movie means a movie that appeals to all four of the major demographic segments Hollywood identifies. Men under 25, men over 25, women under 25 and women over 25. Basically, the more money a movie costs, the broader your audience has to be. So the biggest movies have to be four quadrant movies. One part of that is using broad pattern topics, themes, and structures that are of general appeal, but, and I think this used to be more true, another part is having specific elements intended to appeal to each of those demographics. So Top Gun has cool jet fighters, men winning a war while discovering the essence of manhood, a romance in which a hot, cocky man transforms himself into marriageable material to appeal to his lady, and...
Let's go!
Okay, I get.
And that takes us to point three, looking at men's bodies, because men aren't supposed to look at other men's bodies, right? Like, if we're going to talk about movies expressing cultural values of masculinity, that's the big one, right? Bodies are for women to have. Men get uniforms. Hot women wear bikinis or towels or bedsheets. Hot men wear suits or costumes. They're supposed to have great gym bodies, but you're not supposed to really see them. You're not supposed to really look at them. So when you're looking at this and you're going, this scene is weird, well, it is weird. It's not 100% curated to keep straight men entirely comfortable. And four, this is a Tony Scott joint. If you're not familiar with his work, think Michael Bay, but the movies are good. Experimenting with using filmmaking tools to create powerful effects. Scott's later work includes some of the most famous action movies of a certain era. Movies like Crimson Tide, Enemy of the State, and Spy Game, a movie that makes retasking surveillance satellites seem really cool.
I just don't understand. Operation Dinner Out is a go, confirmed.
Correct. Dinner Out is a go.
His ability to use quick cuts, inserts, dramatic lighting to create energy and to force you to engage emotionally without, critically, losing track of the physical geography and continuity in the scene is unparalleled. You can probably see that best in his commercials, like, here's Tony Scott advertising diet soda. Here's how Tony Scott depicts Anthony Hopkins talking about banks.
Go to America, you want to go to the Big Apple, not the Little Apple. When I get up in the morning, I want a big breakfast. I want my girlfriend to say, good morning, big boy.
He's actually being restrained in Top Gun compared to some of his later movies.
A man can be an artist. And anything, food, whatever.
Top Gun is an editing dream. Like, this is a total cop-out, but I can't even describe it. Somehow, it manages to make you believe, like, never question, that these actors are pilots having actual dogfights in the air, using scraps of footage captured of planes stunt flying, and the actors in prop cockpits. I don't know, let's just look at the beach volleyball sequence again and just watch how this movie assembles a coherent, energetic beach volleyball sequence. Anyway, all of this is supposed to take you away from the literal events and engage based on your emotional impression. After all, this is why we're doing a coming-of-age story in jet planes. So Scott is looking for elemental imagery that conveys not how this should literally look, but how he wants you to feel. And he wants you to feel the bleeding edge, feel the testosterone. These guys are in San Diego in a military training program, and in their downtime, they're hanging out at the bar, playing beach volleyball, going on dates, but Scott wants it to feel like they live their lives at Mach 2, and somehow it does. So, is it a good movie? It is a technical and stylistic wonderland. But the storytelling is underdeveloped and awkward in service of themes that are, if presented interestingly, ultimately kinda regressive and kinda tired. Is it a good movie? Well, I learned a lot. And that brings us back to Top Gun Maverick. How does Maverick follow all that up? Well, it doesn't. At all. Maverick is a sequel insofar as the literal events of Top Gun happened before it. Pete Mitchell was friends with Goose, went to Top Gun, saw Goose die, shot down some MiGs, and made friends with Iceman. Even in terms of the literal story, there's a lot about it that it wants you to have kind of forgotten. The movie wants Goose to have died because naval aviation is dangerous, but it doesn't want Maverick to have gotten Goose killed through completely useless recklessness. It wants Maverick to come back to Top Gun after a long time away, so it quietly smooths over the first movie ending with Maverick becoming a Top Gun instructor. Its cleverest trick in this vein is that Jennifer Connelly's character, Penny Benjamin, isn't Kelly McGillis's character, but if you kinda think that they're the same character, the movie's in no particular haste to disabuse you of that. It's a sequel to Top Gun, but it's more like a sequel to your broad cultural osmosis of Top Gun. It doesn't want you to actually remember Top Gun. And the same is true of the thematics, the genre, the presentation, and the style. Top Gun Maverick is a passing the torch movie. We're getting a bunch of these now as we resuscitate more and more of these IPs whose original actors are still alive, still famous, but clearly a few decades older than they were before. It's a little weird that Top Gun skips straight from Rocky to Creed without the five movies in between.
Was that from the 80s?
That's probably in the 70s.
But, you know, it makes sense. So, basically, your passing the torch story is going to have a younger protagonist who has a coming-of-age story in which he learns to take responsibility for a role that's being passed down to him, while an older protagonist, often the main protagonist, grapples with aging out of their position and learns to take a slightly bittersweet joy in helping someone else achieve what he once had. Specifically, it's the Indiana Jones and the Kingdom of the Crystal Skull variation, where the movie is set up as a passing the torch movie, but then the kid turns out to be kind of a wiener, so the movie ends with the torch not actually getting passed. And that all makes sense. In fact, that's sort of the problem. It all makes sense. Nothing about Top Gun Maverick is that weird, unless you hold it up against Top Gun. It's just a movie, and that just a moviness makes it feel more like a rejoinder to Top Gun's experimentation than a follow-up. Oddly, this is most visible in the scenes that directly reference its predecessor. Take the beach football scene, which is a callback to the volleyball scene we've talked about. You can see how the camera, the cuts, and the color grade are used to directly reference Top Gun, way more than anything else in Maverick. But also notice how much harder it is to figure out what's happening here. The literal progression of events, or the relationship between this scene and the ones around it. So while this scene is meant to communicate competitiveness, velocity, intensity, wildness, this scene isn't really meant to communicate anything. And then they ram in a thematic explanation that isn't actually connected to the story goals.
So why are we out here playing games?
We said to create a team, sir. There's your team.
What are the story goals? It's actually kind of hard to tell because the storytelling's not great. The entire middle act is more or less a catastrophe narratively, as everyone's motivations sort of collapse into a big pile of manufactured hand-wringing. Just as an example, the story spends a ton of time on whether Maverick can lead the mission himself, a question that is fundamentally bizarre to ask given that A, he's clearly the most qualified person for the job, and B, he's Tom Cruise. So when we get to the climax, Maverick is flying the mission, he's picked Rooster to lead the second team, he sacrifices himself to save Rooster, and Rooster came back for him less because that's where the story's been headed to, and more because that's what the story is supposed to have been headed to. So the best I can figure, the basic thematic through line is about the role of a pilot's rebellious spirit in a hidebound and increasingly rule-defined world. So Rooster's problem is that he follows the rules and obeys the constraints he's been taught, instead of pushing himself and his plane past his limits. Maverick's conflicts with his superiors arise from their unwillingness to let him push the limits, whether it's him testing new manned aircraft that they want to replace with drones, or it's him telling pilots they'll need to make their planes do things that their manuals never anticipated. At the closest it gets to anything socially usable, it seems to be expressing a concern that the automation of warfare devalues the things that are noble about conflict and empowers those who care about the political lens of war and not its human toll, which, like, is a theme even Gundam Wing realized it ought to feel a little ambivalent about.
If the mobile dolls are superior, then there's no place for me in this world.
And it's telling how comically fantastical a situation Top Gun Maverick constructs to make any of this workable. Maverick's boss, Rear Admiral Cyclone, is comically inept because Maverick needs an authority figure to rebuke, but in a way that makes no sense in the story itself. We could do an entire essay on the way the movie constructs its enemy, the enemy that is simultaneously A, freakishly advanced with a military more powerful and technologically advanced than anything the US can throw at it, but also B, easily defeated by a handful of fighter pilots in battle, and C, presented as an automatically acceptable target for military action.
Your target is a clear and present threat.
Even though D, we don't know anything about who they are because they are deliberately constructed as completely nameless and faceless.
A secret uranium enrichment site on Rome State Control.
How that represents an overwhelmingly authoritarian viewpoint. How the highest-grossing American and Chinese movies this year are both functionally military propaganda films engaged in constructing acceptable targets and generating a national identity based on hostility to a distant but dangerous other. We won't. But we could. Rather, my point is that the filmmakers have had to craft this incredibly tortured scenario that takes the weird fantasy of the secretly hot Cold War from the first movie and stretches it way past the breaking point. We'll come back to that in a bit, but all of this is in service of literally reversing the argument made back in Top Gun. Top Gun's Pete Mitchell, Maverick, is wrong about everything. He's good at piloting, sure, but he is reckless and dangerous, and the movie's story is the process of humbling him until he can leash his talents to the needs of his colleagues. But Top Gun Maverick's Pete Mitchell has already unlearned that lesson when the movie starts, and instead of relearning it, any of it, he turns out to be right about everything, faces some obstacles because other people are skeptical that he's right about everything, flies so good that everyone else has to admit that he's best at flying, and then turns out to have been right about everything. And that nothing of characterization is only one step less than Miles Teller's Rooster gets, where he has a limitation he needs to overcome and then just doesn't have that limitation anymore. This is Maverick's presentation of manhood. Push yourself past your limits, break the rules, express self-confidence, believe in yourself, and do whatever the shit you want. Accept no restrictions. Steal a military fighter jet. This is what our hero does. Actually, he does it twice. And he turns out to be right about everything. And this is what our hero teaches his apprentice. And our apprentice is shown to be right only when he finally learns this lesson. And just for good measure, the other guy who also performs that version of masculinity comes in to save the day at the very end. Do you see what I mean about all this feeling like a rejoinder to Top Gun? So, it has the fifth highest domestic box office gross of all time. Why? Well, one shouldn't dismiss the push Maverick got from right-wing media, and specifically from Fox News. It was one of the first big movies to stop bothering trying to please Chinese censors, and that got it a lot of positive coverage in that sector, and it's clearly retrograde, soldiers-first, America-only worldview was a big part of it, too. You can scroll through the comments of any YouTube clip from the movie to see the stories of people saying how easy it was to go see it with their dad, and you know the unspoken end to that comment. There's no reason you can't go see Maverick if you also go to every MCU movie, or if you also like little indie movies. But for people who don't go to movies much at all, and who want to see something they can feel pretty confident they're going to just like, well, Top Gun Maverick is here for you too. Plus, it's an old-school four-quadrant movie, just like the last one was. It's got fighter jets going fast and shooting other fighter jets, a man coming to terms with his age while still showing the young bucks what's up, a working single mom being swept off her feet by a really hot single dude who's got his shit together and turns out to be great with kids, and hot shirtless dudes playing beach sports and arguing, this time with a minor character who's a female pilot who can hang with the boys. The last thing Top Gun Maverick is spectacle. It's a lot to look at. In 1986, it took an enormous, a generational triumph of action film editing to persuade you that you were in the cockpit with A-listers piloting jet fighters. In 2022, it took just sticking the A-listers in the jet fighters. Okay, not just. The thing they did was hard. It required a ton of money and time, but it also required a lot of skill. When you see an actor piloting a plane in Top Gun Maverick, you are typically seeing them in the plane. Not flying the plane, but in it, in the co-pilot position, simultaneously acting and operating the camera while the pilot in front of them does the stunt flying. And that's amazing. If it seems like I haven't gone deep on that, it's because I don't know anything about flying planes, acting, or operating cameras, and not because I don't respect that. To make that happen, a way had to be found to get IMAX cameras into jet fighters, and the actors had to be trained both to experience some of the conditions of naval aviation and to operate the cameras while executing their lines under a limited version of those conditions. Even today, to some extent, we go to the movies to see things we can't see anywhere else. It's just that there's so much less we can't see anywhere else. The director, Joseph Kaczynski, says that he and Cruise discussed how they could plausibly exceed the standard that had been set, not by Hollywood, but by pilots sticking GoPros in their actual planes. And they did. It looks great. You are probably getting a sense of an air of sadness from that. You are not wrong. It was amazing. A technical triumph that could only be achieved with a ton of money, a ton of skill, a ton of commitment, and of course a ton of really in-depth cooperation from the United States military, who must be so proud they got Hollywood to not just produce, but finance this mega-budget feature-length recruitment video. It is a movie that cannot ever be made again without every one of those things. And I feel a sense of loss because, for all that Tony Scott's Top Gun is not some phenomenal movie, the thing he did was a miracle of editing and technique. I'm supposed to think Cruise is something for these amazing stunts and on-camera achievements, and I guess I kinda do. But I also think Scott was something for that wizardry, for finding a way to create something more than what's shown on the camera. I think that's lost by the sensibility that what Cruise did, because it's more comfortable, because the meta-narrative of it is more attractive, is the superior version. Anyway, Top Gun Maverick is less of a story and more of a vibe. It transports you into the world of jets going vroom better than you've ever been transported before. Some people will use this wholly as condemnation. Others will use this to excuse it of any of the faults you might assign to stories, to say that you're not really supposed to take it seriously, that this is a Tom Cruise movie, a movie built top to bottom to flatter its star actor, and we should all sit here lucky that its star actor's ego requires him to make visually stunning pictures. Well, you're allowed to have a complex opinion. The vibe doesn't cease to be there if the story's not much to write home about, but the highest grossing movie of the year doesn't cease to speak simply because you wanna like it without thinking about how it influenced you. The original Top Gun is a kinda dumb, deeply weird movie, in part because it's trying to engage with the themes that emerge out of the story, and doing it authentically, ham-fistedly, and with limited success. So when I say Maverick seems like a rebuttal to Top Gun, yeah, it sure is.